Wrestling. All-Star Wrestling is sanctioned by the AWA, the American Wrestling Association. All-Star Wrestling presents the top professional wrestlers from the United States, Canada, England, Germany, Australia, Mexico, Poland, Japan, the greatest professional wrestlers from throughout the world. And now to the ring for All-Star Action.
All right, everybody, here we go with All-Star Wrestling, home of the AWA, the Major League of Professional Wrestling. We've got a tremendous show in store for you today. Among others, you will see the fabulous ones, seven-time NWA champion Harley Race. You will see the current heavyweight champion of the world, Rick Martel, and many, many more. Starting things off, this bout, tag team action, two out of three falls. Introducing first the team on my left. First of all, of Atlanta, Georgia, he weighs in at 216 pounds. He is Rooster Griffin, and his partner at 252 pounds out of Platte Lake, Minnesota, the lumberjack Rick Renslow. And their opponents, coming into the ring area, you can hear their music. At a combined weight of 453 pounds, they hail out of Delray Beach, Florida. Here they are, take a look, they are indeed the fabulous ones, Stan Lane and Steve Kern. You see them now going around ringside, shaking hands with their fans again. Two out of three falls. Your referee for this bout, Eddie Sharkey. Down to you, Rod Trongard.
Hello, everybody, and welcome again to All-Star Wrestling. Joining me at ringside again for another tremendous group of matches, Bobby the Brain Heenan. And Bobby, what's happening here? Stan Lane and Steve Kern got a word or two for you.
Yeah, well, I got a couple words for these two punks, too. They're walking around with their T-shirts that say Weasel Busters on them. They're shaking. They got their stupid-looking white tuxedos on. They call their weasel hunting outfits. They would like to take one of the whole of those bow ties and snap them till their Adam's apple pops. Suspenders. Who dresses them? Walt Disney? They don't have any class at all. It's a couple of punks.
They're out of Delray Beach, Florida, and they are one of the top contenders for the Tag Team Championship of the World, and of course, your own Mr. Saito and Nick Bockwinkel fall into that same category.
Yeah, but the difference with Bockwinkel and Saito is they have me. They have class and ability. As far as these two punks are concerned, all they are is just a bunch of razzle-dazzle. They try to intimidate people. He's lucky that I don't get out of this chair here, go in the ring, rip that T-shirt off him, stuff it down his throat, and then throw Lane over that top rope right into the cement floor. But I'm a gentleman. I don't have to dirty my hands with the likes of the fabulous ones.
And away we go. Rooster Griffin in with Stan Lane. The Rooster hails from Atlanta, Georgia, 216 pounds. Combined weight total for the fabulous ones, 453. They are quick. There's no two ways about that. Ooh, tremendous shoulder block there by Stan Lane.
Rooster. Ooh.
Think he's been listening to you, Bobby. That's what you advocate that a wrestler does, as opposed to coming off that rope, grab a hold of the rope, and preclude getting a flying dropkick or maybe a forearm smash right to the face.
Well, obviously, they've been listening to my comments over the weeks, and they're probably trying to copy some of my strategies. Obviously, couldn't come up with a thought of their own.
Steve Kern is now in for the fabulous ones. And, of course, it was Nick Bockwinkel not all that long ago in a television studio interview that applied the pile driver to Steve Kern on a cement floor that put him out of action for a couple of months. There he is, Steve Kern. He's okay now.
Yeah, they tried to be flashy on TV a while back, and they put their hands on me, and you saw what happened to him. Lane was split open, and Kearns was left laying with his neck jammed about 4 inches down into his body. Where did they get the name The Fabulous Ones? Who gave them that name?
I don't know. Where did you get the name Bobby the Brain?
I've proved I'm the brain. I pull off some of the biggest coups in professional wrestling. I've managed the world's champion. I've managed the world's tag team champions. I've managed the world's champion tag team and the world's heavyweight champion at the same time. What's their claim to fame? They have gaudy clothes?
Well, they certainly have a lot of fans on their side. Don't you wish about that? And some tremendous moves just like that as Steve Kern takes care of both Rick Renslow and Rooster Griffin at the same time. There you see him, Steve Kern.
You know, I've watched these Fabulous Ones, and the more the people chant and the more they cheer for them, it seems like it gets their adrenaline going. Now, if the people would just keep their mouth shut and not say a word, these guys would be lost.
Step over toehold here by Stan Lane. Rick Renslow feeling the force and effect of it. That left leg taking some punishment. Renslow tags off. Nice move
good
by
move,
Renslow.
Good move.
Rolled away from that toehold and tagged in the Rooster. Discretion, the better part of valor, says Rooster Griffin. But then he forgets a cardinal rule of paying attention in the ring, and he ends up paying something else, the price. But he does tag off, and back in comes Rick Renslow.
Brains is the answer. I keep telling you that. Hate to harp on things, and I'm not that kind of a guy that likes to repeat myself and be annoying to people, but you just got to have brains.
The words of Bobby Heenan, four-time manager of the year, manager of Mr. Saito, and Nick Bockwinkel, the head of the Bobby Heenan family. What are they going to do with that left arm? Jam that knee down on the bicep.
It looked to me like he adjusted his knee in there. Maybe he has a knee pad on him. Maybe he's got something in there. It wouldn't surprise me.
No, I don't think so, Bobby. I really don't think so. Well,
come on, Renslow, stay on.
Rooster Griffin hanging on from the outside and Renslow hammering away from the inside. And Steve Kern getting his eyes worked over and now also the midsection. And now the chin. Rooster Griffin firing away with his offensive arsenal. Uh-oh. Big king-size monkey flip on Griffin. And the leg kick. The Miyawashi leg kick. A former Shotokan karate by Stan Lane. And
did they make a tag? I don't believe I saw them make a tag.
Oh, yeah, they did. They did indeed.
Coleco, maker of the Atom Family Computer System, understands that the cost of sending your child to college is growing even faster than your child. Coleco is ready to help.
Be broken, aren't they?
Records are made to be broken.
I've done that too.
Bobby Heenan, along with yours truly, Rod Trongard at ringside, with all-star wrestling action. First fall went to the Fabulous Ones, who have been carrying on a running conversation with Bobby Heenan in between the two falls. Certainly there's no love lost between you people.
Sure, it's easy for them to shoot their mouth up. There's two of them. Mr. Saito's not here. Bockwinkel's not here. They're cheap shot artists. They're the kind of a people that would kick a man from behind, take advantage of any situation.
For our all-star wrestling audience, Mr. Saito will be here later in the program. Mr. Saito, out of Tokyo, Japan, master of the martial arts.
Now, look at that. No tag was made. And these humanoids chant them on and cheer for them. That is appalling.
Well, all the time, Rooster Griffin has been occupying the attention of Eddie Sharkey while all of this has been going on. And yes, indeed, Steve Kern did come in. And now then went out, then came in. Lane is out, and I agree with you, Bobby. There has been no tag, but Rooster Griffin is the cause of it all over here by detaining referee Eddie Sharkey.
Rooster Griffin is trying to merely point out to the man that these two punks are not tagging. The man is standing in his corner. He's not in the ring. He's doing a legitimate, he's got a legitimate gripe there.
Be that as it may.
Oh,
there you go.
Isn't that nice? Right in front of the referee.
Nothing to complain about there. Totally legitimate tag.
I wished I was in there. Oh, be a different tune.
Rick Renslow is in there. Stan Lane is in there. This is the second ball.
Keep him in your corner. Keep him in the corner. Cut the ring off.
A pair of right hands by Rooster Griffin. Thumbs in the eye. Stan Lane being bounced around a bit.
Good kick.
And there's a back heel. And another kick. All forms of Shotokan karate. Small package here. Front face lock, chin lock, turning it around.
See, he's just doing this martial arts little thing here, kicking and stuff like that, because he knows I'm sitting here. He's trying to impress me that he knows martial arts like Mr. Saito.
Forearm smash from Steve Kern. The cover, and that's it. The Fabulous Ones take two straight falls. Steve Kern stopping Rooster Griffith.
Double teaming the man.
Stan Lane getting the first fall. The Fabulous Ones out of Delray Beach, winners one more time on All Star Wrestling.
Wrestling fans, now available from All Stars in Action, but the big, big news, the match the entire world has been waiting for, has signed for right here in St. Louis at Kiel Auditorium. It will be 6'6", 307-pound King Kong Brody to meet 472-pound Jerry Blackwell right here at Kiel Auditorium. Now, fans, a while ago, I had the opportunity, if you will, to talk to the Sheik and King Kong Brody about that very match. Take a listen to just exactly what the two had to say.
I'd be a threat.
It certainly sounds.
I work for the Sheik. I've been telling you that, and I take orders from him, and I'm going to keep taking orders from him. And it better not be a threat. Let me tell you something. I don't know who's got you convinced, who's got the rest of y'all convinced out there. Y'all are so easy. Y'all believe anything out there. Let me tell you something. Jerry Blackwell, he knows how to get the message down here. He knows how to pass them out. He knows how to tell everybody, oh, I'm going to get a hold of that King Kong Brody. Things are going to be a whole lot different next time.
Yes. Yes.
Does he know how to find his way to the airport? I'll tell you what. We'll send him a couple $100, and all he has to do is take it over to the airlines, buy himself a ticket, get his big butt in one of those seats, fly into town, and I'm going to kick his face in. I'm going to kick his face in. That's a whole lot easier to be talking about what you're going to do 1,600 miles away. Fat Crusher Blackwell, that's a whole lot different when you get here. And when you do get here, I'm going to be waiting.
Well, fans, all I can say is, you know what Jerry Blackwell had to say. You heard what the Sheik and Brody. If that match comes to pass, I guarantee you it's one you won't want to miss. We'll be back. Fans, remember, Friday, October 5th, St. Louis, Kiel Auditorium, the match you've all been waiting for. 6'6", 307-pound King Kong Brody to meet 472-pound Jerry Blackwell. Tag team title defense, the Road Warriors to meet Ted DiBiase and Buzz Tyler. Mr. USA, Tony Atlas to meet Paul Ellering. Dick the Bruiser against Hacksaw Higgins. The Grapplers versus Brown and Brunzel. Friday, October 5th, Kiel Auditorium. Don't you dare miss it.
Fans, this bout, one fall. Introducing first in the corner to my left, out of Amarillo, Texas. He weighed in at 230 pounds. He is Craig Carson. Carson. And his opponent out of Kansas City, Missouri, at 270 pounds, seven times NWA heavyweight champion. He is Harley Race. Race, your referee, Kenny J, one fall.
You'll have to excuse me, Mr. Trunger. I'm going to go up to the ring and watch this a little closer. That's my man, Harley Race, in there. Seven times NWA champion.
One question before you leave, Bobby Heenan. Is he the newest member of the Bobby Heenan family?
No comment from Bobby Heenan as he makes his way to ringside to assume his managerial position now for this match, which features Harley Race. Harley, win at any price. Race. Craig Carlson certainly knows he is in a match. Look at that soup play by handsome Harley Race. He could have pinned Carson right there. Instead, picking him up and bent on more punishment, more devastation. Now taking instructions from Bobby Heenan. Now the pile driver as that neck of Craig Carson is rearranged. And again, Harley Race could pin his man. Decides instead to hand out more and more punishment. Race with another soup play. Here is a cover. The count of two. He could have pinned him again. Referee Sodbuster J. Kenny Sodbuster J. Watching very closely. Craig Carson. Harley Race grilling him from start to finish. Rips a punch to the eye. Drills him with a headbutt. Drills him again. Race now with a cover. Is he going to pin him? No. Come on, Kenny J. Make him pin him or disqualifying, one or the other. Again, Race ripping away on the face, the head of Craig Carson. Now, again, the body slam. And again, he picks him up. Again, Kenny J warns him. He should be disqualified. And down goes Jay. And that is physical abuse of the referee. And that is automatic disqualification. Look at that suplex. Kenny J has asked for the ringing of the bell. And in comes Kurt Hennig, ripping away on Harley Race. Craig Carson, beaten and battered. Kurt Hennig gives the axe to Harley Race. Bobby Heenan comes in and hammers Hennig the back of the head. Now, Kurt Hennig, look out from behind as Harley Race hammers away. And now he has the arms of Kurt Hennig pinned behind him. And Bobby Heenan takes up the bandage covering a cut on Kurt Hennig's head and rips right hands to the forehead time and time again. And that cut reopens, and here comes Larry the Axe Hennig, and an elbow smash to the back of the head of Bobby Heenan, and Larry the Axe goes to work on his former tag team partner, handsome Harley Race. And now you see Kurt Hennig ripping away on the right of your screen on Bobby Heenan. Larry Hennig with the whip on Harley Race. The elbow smash sends Heenan to his knees. A forearm smash sends Race to his back. An elbow smash by Larry the Axe Hennig. Elbow smashes and axes by Kurt Hennig. And now suddenly both Harley Race and Bobby Heenan are sent sprawling from the ring. And the entire arena is on its feet applauding what has happened here. As suddenly it was Kurt Hennig coming in, and then Harley Race, or rather than Larry the Axe Hennig. Larry the Axe coming out of the ring. Harley Race is on the floor just below him. Starts to move away. Bobby Heenan ripped open the cut again on the forehead of Kurt Hennig. And that's going to need some more stitches to close. There you see a close-up of it. Absolutely no respect, no love lost, distaste and hatred on the part of the Hennigs for Harley Race and Bobby Heenan.
Wrestling fans, I still can't believe my eyes. Just another instance of Bobby Heenan interfering, sticking his nose in where he had no business, here in the studio all over the country. And Lord knows, if Larry the Axe had not been here, what kind of damage Harley Race and Heenan would have done to Kurt Hennig. Obviously out to injure the young Hennig. He's been coming out like gangbusters.
Well, I'm going to tell you something right now. I've had it. You know, Harley Race has started with you, but you've been trying to put this boy, this man, out of business since he started in the AWA. It was you who started with you. Now it's Heenan. It's the Road Warriors. It's Bockwinkel. And you see what Heenan just did here? All these tag teams are trying to put him out. They didn't want to try it when I was king of the hill. Now they're coming. They're coming. They're strong. They're trying to. They know that someday this guy's got a chance of being the champion of the world. Well, I'm going to tell you one thing right now. I've had it. And I'm going to tell you another thing. We're putting out a challenge to anybody in the world, any tag team in the world right now. I might have been on the shelf for a while, but I've been around the world wrestling. I know what's going on, and I'm in shape. But I'm going to tell you one thing right now. The challenge is out. If you pick on one Hennig, you got to pick on both Hennigs. And I'm going to tell you a thing right now. I don't care if it's the Road Warriors. I don't care if it's Saito at Bockwinkel. I don't care who it is. You're going to get a lesson. My boy and myself will challenge anybody. If they want a war, if they want to get in the AWA and start some crap, they're going to get it. Because I've had it, and Kurt's had it. So let me make you one thing perfectly clear. When you fight with one Hennig, you fight with two Hennigs, and that's a war. Mr. High, Mr. Low, straight speed, we got it. And Heenan, I'm telling you, you got it coming, and Harley Race, you started a war, and that's going to be the end of it.
Well, what, Kurt Hennig, I don't know if you heard what your dad has said, if you can even talk, Kurt. He is saying that he is ready to step back in the ring with you at any time.
And I couldn't be more excited, because this is something that's been having to take place for a long time. Harley Race, for what you did to me, for what you did to my father, I don't care. I don't care if it's Bockwinkel and Saito. I don't care if it's the Road Warriors. Everywhere I go, it's 2-on-1. Well, I got news for you. This man, my father, I couldn't have a prouder partner to be proud of. And I'm going to tell you this. You want to play games 2-on-1? You want to play it? You're going to play it this way. You're going to play the way the Hennigs play, and you're going to see the way
Kurt. You heard it from now on. It's Kurt and Larry back together again.
They're going to have
it. We'll be back. I still can't believe it. Action continues here on All Star Wrestling. This bout, one fall. Introducing first the corner to my left out of West Memphis, Arkansas. He weighs in at 247 pounds. He is Bruce Dean. Dean. And his opponent at 237 pounds out of Quebec City, Canada, the heavyweight champion of the world is Ricky Martel. Martel, one fall down a Rod Tron Garden ringside.
And very conspicuous by his absence at ringside, Bobby the Brain Heenan, who just minutes ago, along with Harley Race, were pretty much taken apart by the combination of Larry the Axe Hennig and his son, Kurt Hennig. Ricky Martel, the heavyweight champion of the world, 237 pounds. In fine shape, in excellent shape, standing heavyweight champions of all time. His match with Brad Rangins not all that long ago was truly a classic. Rick Martel defending that championship anywhere and everywhere across Canada, the United States, Tokyo, Japan. Here's a big back body drop, and Bruce Dean felt that one. Oh, yes, indeed. Single leg pickup here by the champion. And the elbow smash to the quadricep area of that leg. And a knee drop on that quadricep. And now pressure on the inside of the left knee. Tremendous pressure being put on Bruce Dean. If you're wondering why Bobby Heenan is not here, well, I cannot tell you completely. Other than he and Harley Race made a very, very quick exit following the preceding match between Craig Carson and Harley Race. Oh, Ricky Martel. Look at that from the champion. And a quick single leg pickup by Martel. A champion in every sense of the word is this young man out of Quebec City, Canada. The word precocious is used about Ricky Martel. Indeed, he was a talented athlete ever since he was just a young, young man. Working on the hamstring now. Again, he goes to work on that left leg. One thing that the good ones, the great ones do, and Martel, of course, is one of that number, is once they have a man hurt, they continue to put punishment on whatever area of the body that they were working on. In this case, it's the left leg of Bruce Dean. Look at that cartwheel by Martel. Again, he goes to work on the left leg. Example of the very thing I was talking about just seconds ago. Good close-up of the champion. All kinds of pressure here by Martel, but Dean does make his way to that lower rope strand, and Martel breaks the hold. That's the kind of a champion, that's the kind of an athlete he is. True champion. But taking some punishment now from Bruce Dean, who got the advantage by raking the eyes. There's a fist to the forehead. Fingers across the eyes again. I believe he's biting the champion. Martel blinded for the moment. Dean continues to fire away. You better get him while you can, Dean. You may not get another chance. The ire, the French temper of Rick Martel on display. Martel, the Irish whip. Oh, look at that drop kick. That stopped Bruce Dean in his tracks. Martel to apply some more punishment. There's the backbreaker on Dean. And now, the swan dive, is that what we're going to see? Yes, it is. That's it. And that's all. 1, 2, 3 for Ricky Martel, the heavyweight champion of the world, showing you exactly why he is the heavyweight champion of the world. Good work, Ricky Martel.
All right, fans, that, of course, the heavyweight champion of the world, Rick Martel, in action. But as part of that tremendous card coming up here at Kiel Auditorium on October the 5th, the precious one, if you will, being forced to wrestle into a match against Mr. USA, Tony Atlas.
The AWA will learn you don't get into a spitting contest with a snake. Tony Atlas, you will also learn. Now, everybody that was in the Kiel Auditorium saw the greatest team, the greatest wrestling organization, the Legion of Doom, at the last time that we were there. And you people will remember that the Legion of Doom defeated the Bruiser and Blackjack Lanza. Now, they forced the precious one into the ring. Tony Atlas, you're a half-horsepower brain that drives a 10-ton body. How do you feel that you can match up to a man who has mastered Wall Street, who is a wizard of Wall Street, if you will? You have no chance, Tony Atlas. I will send you back to the other side of tracks where you belong. Now, these two men were the biggest thing that St. Louis has seen in years. Tell them, Animal.
Hey, first of all, Atlas, you better watch your hide, brother. You try to your ghetto tricks with Precious Paul, you got to answer to the Warriors. And DiBiase, still trying to live off your old man's name, huh? Well, forget it. Nobody lives off a reputation with the Warriors. And Buzz Tyler, huh? You're going to find out what the wrath is all about. Tell him, brother.
Hey, if me and Animal had just a penny for every two-bit punk that thought he was going to make a name against us, we'd be trillionaires. So, DiBiase and Tyler, you want to add to our trillions, you step up in line. We're going to be rich.
Nobody can.
Fans, you heard of the R&D, the Road Warriors. Stay with us. We'll be back. Civic Center, won by Jerry Blackwell, the Cheek Adnan El, Casey King Kong, Brody and Abdullah the Butcher, perpetrated perhaps the most vicious double cross in all of professional wrestling. Actions that put Jerry Blackwell on the shelf for these past few months. Now, before we talk to the big man out of Stone Mountain, Georgia, let's go back to the St. Paul Civic Center and join the end of that battle royal and the ensuing action. Take a look now. The action is already in progress.
Jerry Blackwell has won this battle royal, but the battle still goes on. And King Kong Brody is hammering away as Abdul the Butcher holds Jerry Blackwell, who is a bloody, beaten mess. Abdul, Adnan El Casey is there. Other wrestlers are coming to the ring now, supposedly to the aid of Jerry Blackwell. Into the ring they come. Kurt Hennig is in there. Dusty Rhodes has come in. Oh, what a royal battle this is getting to be. The Fabulous Ones are back in there, and they are trying to work over King Kong Brody. Also, Adnan El Casey and Abdul the Butcher. They are in a fight for their lives inside that squared circle. Jerry Blackwell has won this match and has won the $100,000. But they are fighting nonetheless inside the ring. Adnan El Casey is chased. Who is still there? Abdul the Butcher is now chased. And King Kong Brody is also left. But look out! Here comes King Kong Brody into the ring with a chair. One of the Fabulous Ones, Stan Lane, grabs a hold of him, as does the other. It's going to take three or four to stop this man. He has gone absolutely berserk, absolutely wild. He is a crazy man in there. They are trying to extricate the chair from him. Kurt Hennig is there. The Fabulous Ones are there. Dusty Rhodes is there. And now King Kong Brody comes over and foot stops. Was it the referee or was it Jerry Blackwell who is still laying flat on his back in that ring? We cannot see from here. The battle royal is over, but the battle royal goes on. And back in comes Abdul the Butcher. King Kong Brody working over somebody on the floor of that ring. Now Brody comes out of the ring, but is he going to be out for long? Abdul the Butcher is hammered to the canvas. This has gone completely out of control. Jerry Blackwell, flat on his back. Blackwell being worked over for a long, long time after he had won the $100,000 and had won the battle royal. But King Kong Brody and Abdul the Butcher and Sheik Adnan El Casey took it upon themselves to go after Jerry Blackwell. And Blackwell is indeed in a very, very bad way and could very well, very easily be seriously injured. The referee, Marty Miller, Jim Mitchell, Bob Grazinger, promoter Wally Carbo, along with the other wrestlers, Dusty Rhodes, the Fabulous Ones, Kurt Hennig, all in the ring at the present time, checking on Jerry Blackwell.
Well, wrestling fans, as you can see, watching the tape with me of that battle royal was none other than Jerry Blackwell. And Jerry, last week we heard the interview you conducted with Gordon Solie, asking, demanding for King Kong Brody. You've now got Brody. But Jerry, I've got to ask you, both twofold, are you certain you're ready, not only physically, but mentally? Have you recovered from the pain and agony you went through following that brutal beating?
Well, first of all, I want everybody to know this. I went back in the ring several times, but I didn't feel ready. So I went back home and I got on my tractor and I plowed in the fields. And I went out and I picked up bales of hay all day long. Yeah, I'm a country boy. And I know you've been knocking country people. Well, let me tell you this. I want y'all to watch this tape of the Battle Royal. What you did to me. I wish they'd show it right now. Do you see me laying there? Do you see me bleeding? And I'm not able to get up. I needed help. And I've never needed that all my life. I went around with a big chip on my shoulder. I've never wanted anybody to help me do anything. But now, I realize there's a lot of people in the world that will help you and not ask anything of it. But not you, Casey. No, not you, Bruiser Brody. Not you, Abdullah the Butcher. But a lot of people. Dusty Rhodes come down to the ring to help me. And a lot of other people come down to the ring and help me. And the people were standing up chanting for me. Something I never heard before. And it stirred up something inside of this country boy. And you better believe, King Kong Brody, you better believe that I'm ready. I didn't need the picture. I didn't need to see it. Because I remembered for 4 months. In the hot sun on the tractor. I remembered when I was plowing my garden. I remembered when I was slopping my hogs. And when I get in the ring with you, I'm gonna leave you laying just like you left me. And when I get to you, Adnan LKC, I'm gonna leave you in pieces. I'm gonna leave you worse than me. And I'm gonna enjoy every minute of it. And you talk about mean and bad and nasty. Well, that's exactly what this country boy is gonna be.
Fans, it'll be Jerry Blackwell and King Kong Brody, a battle of the giants of professional wrestling. If there ever was one, I'm certain a match you won't want to miss. Stay with us. We'll be back.
48 pounds out of Tokyo, Japan, is Mr. Saito. Saito, your referee, Kenny J.
Conspicuous by his absence from ringside, Bobby the Brain Heenan, who was with us earlier in this all-star wrestling television show, but also he is conspicuous by his absence from the corner of Mr. Saito. Apparently, Bobby the Brain Heenan paid a very dear, dear price for going to ringside with Harley Race. And then enter the Hennigs, Kurt and Larry the Axe, and the war was on. Mr. Saito, 248 pounds out of Tokyo, Japan. Tremendous, tremendous wrestler, no two ways about that. And giving a pretty good lesson right now to the Black Panther, the 240-pounder out of Detroit. Saito, as he oftentimes does, goes on the offensive, and he does not let up until it is all over. We may be seeing that here and now. Certainly the Black Panther is being bounced from pillar to post. Mr. Saito showing all of his wrestling talents, including the martial arts, judo, karate. See what he's got in store here. Oh! Going to work on the trapezius muscles alongside that neck. The Black Panther finds the ropes. Mr. Saito breaks the hold. But very, very quickly, he is back on the attack. Ripping away at the Black Panther. The Panther has absolutely done nothing offensively since the very start of this match. He has been on the defensive all the way, and not much of a defense, we might say. Not only might, but do. Again, tremendous pressure from tremendously strong hands by Mr. Saito. Kenny the Sidebuster J is the referee, checking with the Black Panther to see if he wants to submit. The Panther is saying no. You see the look on his face, excruciating pain that he is in right now. He makes it to the ropes. But Mr. Saito is right on top of him, rifling away with right hands. Saito. Suplex, body to body, cover. It is all over. And Mr.
Mr. Saito went on the attack at the very start, never let up. The Black Panther never got a lick in this one. And Saito wins on All-Star Wrestling.
Wrestling fans, you just saw Mr. Saito in action. Now, how Bobby Heenan can walk out to that corner like absolutely nothing happened today is beyond me. But matchmaker Wally Carbo, Wally, I understand you've been on the phone in conference with AWA President Stanley Blackburn. Any sanctions, any ramifications to be taken against Bobby Heenan?
Short and sweet. Stanley Blackburn, the president of the AWA, agreed with me for the past interference with Heenan's conduct, interfering in the matches, past 10 years. Heenan is through with the AWA. He is definitely suspended. He will not wrestle for the AWA or manage.
Well, fans, you just heard the bombshell. Bobby Heenan out of the AWA, it looks like, for good.
And I'm glad to hear that because we ain't got no Weezer well. You know, that's one thing that Wally did that I like. I like the way the AWA do business. They got rid of one Rhett. They got rid of one Bobby Heenan. But now you got another one. You got Pressure Paul Ellering. Paul, you get out here, you say I ain't got no brain. Might be true. You get out here, you say that I got a big body and I ain't got nothing upstairs. I ain't got no education. I ain't got this. You say I wear rags. You say you got this and you got that. Paul, you can say what you want to say about me. You can talk about me all you want to talk about me. A lot of things people don't know about Paul Ellering. I used to read about that Paul Ellering. And that man, at one time, he was world weightlifting champion. And now he's a professional wrestler. He managed one of the dynamic teams in the world today called the World Warriors. And Warriors, y'all say that if I do something to Paul Ellering, I get a chance to get in the ring with you. Well, I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to whip that boy like a drum. Because I was talking to Paul Ellering's doctor the other day, and he told me he told Paul to come down for one of them blood tests. And he said Paul stayed up all night to study for it. And he said if that boy IQ was 1 point less, he'd be a banana. And that's two things that old friend of mine named Ernie Ladd told me. There's two things I don't like, and that's a dog chasing cars and a broken-down wrestler chasing me. Paul Ellering.
Fans, he is indeed Mr. USA Tony Atlas. We'll see you again next week. So long, everybody.